Hey everybody, Darren Borles here. Today I'm with Corey and Tiffany Young out of Edmonton, Alberta. Corey and Tiffany, I've known them for years. They are the joint venture experts. They've done hundreds of transactions and joint venture deals, and I'm so excited that they're here today to walk us through how joint venture partnering works. Before we get into it today with Corey and Tiffany, if you haven't done so already, you can subscribe to my channel, hit the notification bell, and please feel free to leave comments and questions below for me. Without further ado, let's get into it. Corey, Tiffany, great to have you guys here. Why don't you give us a bit of an intro on who you are and what you guys do as real estate investors before we jump into joint venture partnering?
Well, thank you for having us to begin with. And awesome topic. We love joint venturing. That's what we teach people to employ that strategy when they're wanting to really scale their business or even get started. Because I know a lot of people don't have, you know, going back to our story, when we first got started, we didn't have the money. We didn't necessarily have the credit, but we did know that we wanted to buy real estate and do it as a business. And so joint venturing was essential for us to get going.
We didn't have a choice. We, if we had money, we may have had a choice, but we didn't have any money. So for us to buy real estate, which we knew was powerful and could do so much for us, the only way was joint venturing. So that's how we came to, you know, like you said, we bought quite a bit of property and 98% of it was by joint venturing. So someone else gave us the money to do it. We partnered and we split profits on it.
Let's break down joint venturing, because I think a lot of people hear that term, but they may not really fully understand it. So explain what a joint venture partnership is.
Really simple terms. It's where two people come together that have two different assets. So let's say that you know about real estate investing, you understand it, you've got the education for it or whatever it might be, but you don't have any money. So you find someone who does have money and maybe they don't have their education. They don't know about it. They understand it a little bit, but they don't know all the ins and outs of, you know, property management and all that, you know, detail kind of stuff. So they bring their asset, which is money. You bring your asset, which is expertise and the time to do the work. You come together, you partner on a property. So one person brings the money, one person brings the time, and you hold on to it for whatever your plan is. When you sell it, the person that brought the money gets their money back first and foremost. Mm-hmm. And then any profits that are there are split 50-50 between the two of you.
What is the benefit, I would say? Because I get this question a lot when I'm talking about joint venture partnerships, especially from my money partners. The question becomes, why do I need somebody else in this transaction? If I'm qualifying for the financing and I'm putting up the down payment, what is the benefit of me working with a joint venture partner?
A lot of people want to invest in real estate, but they don't want to do the work. They don't want the headaches. They don't want to deal with the tenants. They don't even want to deal with a property management company. And so that's really where a joint venture partner comes in, because all of those headaches and all of that work is taken off their shoulders, and that becomes the responsibility of the working partner. And so that was our responsibility in that setup, is that we did everything. And so literally our money partners put down the money, qualified for the mortgage, and we did every single other thing that was involved with it, including reporting to them on a regular basis as to how well the investment was doing. And so those were the people we were looking for, people who wanted to invest in real estate, but wanted none of the headaches that go along with it.
And you mentioned, Tiff, you kind of broke it down into those two categories, like the working partner and the money partner. That's a pretty standard, I would say, relationship inside of joint venturing. Is there anything outside of that that you guys have seen on another sort of common scenario? Maybe like, is there a money partner? Is there a qualifying partner? And is there a working partner? Have you seen that scenario too? And can you break that down a little bit?
So those scenarios are, there's a million ways that it can actually be set up. You know, a lot of times we talk about just the standard way, it's, you know, 50-50 split. But in more than, I would say almost, you know, 40% of the joint ventures we did, they weren't 50-50. So, you know, certain gains or gains in equity were split up differently than the cash flow. And, you know, so you can set it up many different ways. In all of our cases, we just had one money partner and we were the working partner. But again, like you said, you can have it where there's different responsibilities given to different people, and you can have more than two sides to that equation.
So at the end of the day, you have a deal, you need to get it done. Now, whether you find one partner for that or maybe two, we don't usually go beyond that. But let's say one guy can bring the financing and one guy can bring the money and we can bring the work. So if we need to split that up, you know, what's the fair split? Is that, you know, going three ways? Maybe if that's what everyone wants. So it comes down to, you know, finding out what your partners want and need out of the deal, and then making sure that that works for you, and going with it. So that the winning deal is one that gets done. Yeah. And whatever the splits come at, as long as they're reasonable and fair, doesn't really matter. And yeah, you can split it up. You can cut that pie a few different ways.
Let's go back to that 50-50 scenario and let's talk about the responsibilities of the working partner. I think the money partner is relatively straightforward, but just break it down. What's the money partner's responsibility in let's say a standard 50-50 case? And what is the working partner's responsibility?
So money partner's responsibility, I'll start with that. Pretty simple, supply the money, write the check as far as the down payment is concerned, and then qualify for the mortgage and maintain that mortgage. So, you know, when it comes up for renewal, they'll need to do the renewal for that mortgage in most cases. And so that's really the end of their responsibility is qualifying and supplying the money in the down payment.
If there's a renovation involved, and a lot of people are using like the BRRRR strategy, buy, renovate, refinance, rent, repeat, who comes up with that capital in that scenario? Would you still ask the money partner to come up with that now down payment capital, closing capital, and renovation capital? Or would this be something that a working partner, well, let's stay with that 50-50 split. Would that come from the working partner?
In 99% of the cases, in our experience, yes, the money partner comes up with it because that's part of the money. So
we also had no money, so we didn't have any other option.
We didn't have a choice. Yeah.
That was the only choice we had. But there are some people that will do variations of it. And, you know,
And there's a difference, too, if that renovation is occurring when you purchase the property right up front. So then that amount of money can be accounted for up front and asked for from the money partner. Part of the spreadsheets that you'd be supplying to them when making a decision to buy. But if sometimes that renovation is maybe 5 or 10 years down the road and now, you know, there's a cost that's coming up and a renovation needs to be done. In some of those cases, yes, we did supply some of the money, and then we got paid back that money before the splits as well, just like the money partner gets paid back their money before the splits occur.
Tiff, tell us about the working partner. What's their responsibility?
Well, I can tell you about it because I've been that working partner for 18 years. I've been, because some of our joint ventures, we plan to keep for, you know, 5 to 7 years. And, you know, 13, 14, 15 years later, we're still owning those properties with those same joint venture partners. So, yeah, I mean, we do everything. It's not just managing the property. And I think that's a really key point too. It's also managing, you know, the investment. So everything from the bookkeeping and making sure that the taxes are done properly and filed, to, you know, paying those bills, dealing with the tenants, dealing with any contractors that, you know, whatever, need help, but also just, you know, advertising the properties and filling them. Even if you use a property manager, like some of our properties, we had a property manager for, that, you know, that came out of the cash flow of the property, but I still had to manage those property managers. And sometimes that's, you know, a thing in itself, but you know, the banking and, you know, dealing with condo boards or stratas, if there are any, and, homeowners associations and, you know, any issues that come up anywhere, vacancies and taking care of the lawn while it's, you know, vacant or the snow or whatever it might be. So, yeah, there's just a whole lot involved. We have like a 150 point list on the responsibilities of a working partner in managing the investment.
Yeah, it's a lot more than just managing the property. Like Tiff said, you're managing that investment and, you know, reporting to your joint venture partners and, you know, filling out those spreadsheets on a yearly or some people do it every 6 months, but letting them know how well their investment dollars are doing and the returns that they're gaining on it. That's another important part of being a working partner.
And it's really bringing somebody into your system, right? It's like, You've got this machine that is operating and you've put all the pieces together. And really the only thing you're now doing is plugging this new money partner into the transaction and they get to take advantage of everything that you've built as that in that system.
For sure. Your way of dealing with tenants and renewing leases and advertising and your filing system, like down to simple things, like how do you file all of your stuff for sure.
run us through the end of the transaction, because you kind of touched on it briefly, but I think there's also a little bit of a misconception that as a money partner, I'm coming into the deal, I put down $100,000 into the transaction. There's sometimes a perception of you have 50-50 ownership. So now do I get access to my, do I lose $50,000 right off the bat? Explain the end of the process when we go to either refinance or sell, how the money gets distributed and how that works.
Absolutely. So, you know, that property gets sold and there is a lot of confusion, like you said, about what happens to that money. But it's very simple. All the money is calculated that work or that money partner would have put into the investment from the beginning to the end. How much did they input into it? That amount upon the sale of the property gets returned to them.
First.
Then after that gets, so let's say they put in that 100,000, they get their 100,000 back. Okay. Now, if there's anything left over, if there's anything remaining from the mortgage being paid down, from the property going up in value, or any cash flow that's been accumulated, anything that's remaining, that's where the percentages come into play. That's where it gets split 50-50 or whatever percentage you chose. So they get their money back first, and then the gains. And that's why it's so important for a working partner to do a good job, because they don't get anything if the property never made any money,
yeah.
You know? And so that's why they have that vested interest in really making sure that the investment as a whole works and they're buying the right properties to begin with and all of those kinds of things so that they can make some money at the end.
How do both parties protect their interests in a joint venture agreement?
They both sign a legal document, which you know, spells out what property it entails, who the partners are, what their percentages are.
Responsibilities.
And then depending on what province in the country you're in, you know, they all deal with it slightly differently. But in most cases, that joint venture agreement gets put on title as a caveat type of idea.
So
then their interest or that, if somebody can't sell that property without that joint venture agreement being satisfied.
So I'll just kind of clarify on that. So because the bank or the lender most likely is going to require that the property go in the name of the person qualifying for the mortgage, which is the money partner, then us as working partners, you know, our name isn't on that property. It's not technically or legally ours, but we do have that vested interest in that joint venture agreement. Or a caveat or lien of some other sort, depending on the province you're in, gets registered on that title, just so that it's very clear that we do have legally a right to 50% of those profits or whatever we've worked out.
From the legal perspective, that's governed by the joint venture agreement. What about taxes? What, just because you're not on the mortgage on the title, as a working partner, you're still responsible for your split on paying taxes on that income that's earned?
Absolutely. Yeah. So, you know, you have you essentially have a beneficial interest in that property, you know, at whatever percentage you have. And so on a yearly basis, if there's been any income or you know, as far as cash flow is concerned, then yeah, you're paying taxes on whatever income you're making based on the percentage of ownership. So both the working partner and the money partner, hopefully the property is making money. So really, hopefully you're paying some taxes in some respect when it comes to that property.
What's a common term for a joint venture agreement in terms of years, and what are my exit options as a joint venture partner or as a money partner?
Well, it's interesting that a common term, it depends on your market. So some markets can, you know, facilitate a short, and it depends on your strategy. Mm-hmm. If you're doing, like, I know you take partners for your, you know, fix and flips, you take partners for your long-term holds, you know, so it depends on the strategy that you're doing at the time where, you know, where that exit would come in. But, you know, it also depends on the market. So if you're in a market that, you know, is appreciating slow and steady, you might need a longer term to hold that property because you want that mortgage to get paid down. You want that cash flow rents to be raised so that you're, you know, making more money on it. So you might need to go in for a longer term. I would say on average, people start out for a long-term buy and hold at about 5 years-ish. There is a clause in the joint venture agreement that says, you know, if the property goes up by more than 25%, then we'll have a discussion and see if we want to sell, because we will have hit kind of our terms at that point. So, you know, we were, some of our properties went up like crazy within, you know, the first couple of years. And so we'd say to people, do you want to sell? Couple did. Most said, no, we're happy. We're going to stick around. And so our 5 to 7 year plans have turned into, in some cases, 16, 17 years. But that's because we do buy and hold in a market that's fairly flat.
And we just have that discussion with our joint venture partners on a yearly basis. And we say, hey, listen, you know, when we're giving them our reporting, we say, this is where the property's at. If we were to sell today, this is how much we would all get out of it. This is our return on investment. And what do you think? Should we keep going or should we sell? What do you feel like? And we have that discussion. It's all about clear communication with our money partners. And that's so, so important in this business.
Do you guys ever buy out your partners in that situation too? Like if your money partner wanted to exit, you have something in the joint venture agreement, I'm guessing, that says I've got first right of refusal on this property before we take it to market. Could you buy out their interest and keep owning that property? Have you done that?
We've sold properties. We've
to
bought
our
out
partners.
To our partners. They've bought us out of some properties. We've bought some properties out from our partners. And then in a lot of cases, we've just sold the property and split the profits at that point. So it just really depends on the property, depends on what the partner wants, that kind of thing.
So for example, though, let's say we were joint ventured and you were our money partner. You came to us 5 years in and you said, okay, Corey and Tiff, I'm done. I want my money out. And, we said like, oh man, like we love this property. We want to keep it. We don't want to sell it. So basically you being the guy that decided that you want out, you get to pick a number. So you state a number. Let's say you say 350,000. And then we look at it and we go, okay, is that a good price for us to sell to him at, or do we want to buy it from him at that price? And so it's called the shotgun clause, and it basically keeps us really honest. You're basically, it's like when you're a kid and you had, your mom had like, there's one piece of pie left or one piece of cake. Your mom said, all right, Darren, you're going to cut it, but your brother's going to pick which piece he gets. So it's going to keep you really, really like as close to center and fair as possible. Or else, you know, you're going to get the short end of the stick. It's kind of the same exact thing there.
I love the analogy. That's the best way I've ever heard it explained, for sure. Anything related to food is really easy to understand.
Especially cake.
I love it. We all know that real estate, you know, you mentioned it earlier, it's never perfect. I've made a ton of mistakes as a real estate investor starting out. I still make mistakes now. They just seem to be getting smaller and insequential, but they're still there for sure. What's been a scenario that you guys have had that's come up, you know, it's been a little bit troublesome or a tough situation to deal with in a joint venture partnership, or what should people watch out for?
Really good question. Mm-hmm. I think where we made a lot of mistakes, especially in the early days, was, you know, we were really eager to add numbers to our portfolio. So it was like, you know, we wanted to have 20 properties by this point, whatever it might be. And so we kind of pushed some of the numbers to match what we were wanting. So rather than look at the property and say it cash flows or it doesn't, and whether you love it or not, you know, it must cash flow. Some of it was like, well, it doesn't really cash flow, but maybe if we manage this one ourselves, and well, if I manage it really well, I can put my vacancy allowance at, you know, 2% when really it should have been 5%, or we'll, you know, do the repairs on it ourselves. So our, you know, repairs and maintenance, we only need to put that was a mistake at 1%.
I'm not a handy guy at all. Yeah. I hate doing renovations. I'll get it done if I need to, but that's the part of the business I do not enjoy, is doing renovations. So yeah, we found that out along the way.
But pushing those numbers when really they weren't there, but because of our emotion getting involved, and we pride ourselves in saying, no, this is a business, we're not going to get emotionally involved. But looking back, we did. So I'd say that was a big mistake.
You know what? Another one that I think is common, and it is when we were doing our buying, we were buying a lot of townhouses in Edmonton, and they were priced at like $89,000, $89,500. And we had a lot of buying opportunities and joint venture partners that were ready to buy.
Yeah.
But when the values went up to 91,000 or 92,000, it was like, these are so way overpriced. And we got caught up in thinking, oh, we had to buy every townhouse for 89,000 or whatever it was. And so we walked away from a lot of really good deals that now are worth $200,000 to $300,000 that we could have gained a lot of equity in, but we walked away because we were being a little too picky on the buying side.
And so, maybe.
You know, like I tell people, yeah, all the time, if it doesn't make sense and you're squabbling over $1,000, $2,000, even $5,000 on the purchase price, it's probably not the property you should be looking at anyways. So don't walk away from really good opportunities if you have them in front of you.
I think it's a great point. I think so many, Tiff, you, I think you kind of slid it in there too. It's just like people want to win, right? They want to win in negotiations. It's not necessarily about the price. On the purchase side, is it going to make a difference of $1,000, $2,000 here and there? Probably not in the end. But if you don't have that property, that's going to make a big difference in your portfolio for sure.
You know, the biggest no that you're going to hear is generally from yourself. And that's often, you know, well, I don't have any experience. Well, neither did we. You know, well, I'm too young. I'm too old. I'm, you know, there's every excuse in the book, but that often just comes down to confidence. And so education can help you to gain that confidence. But also sometimes just looking at, you know, people say, like I had a stay-at-home mom. She's like, I've been a stay-at-home mom for 25 years. What, like how is anyone going to give me money? Yet she had five kids all in like competitive hockey, competitive ballet, you know, whatever. She ran her home like a well-oiled machine. And that's exactly, and plus she was so like easy to talk to. I mean, tenants will love you, you know, for you to manage renovations. And, you know, somehow all of her kids got fed. They all got to school. Their homework was all done. You know, they were happy and healthy. They were in vans and minivans and drop-offs and pick all somehow all of these people's schedules were run. That's exactly what you need as a property manager. That's exactly what you need as an investment manager. You need to be able to, you know, really
multitask.
Yeah. So anyways, the whole point is that she made a fantastic investor because she had all of that stuff under control. But sometimes we don't relate our real life and or career experience in another field to bringing that into real estate. So, you know, are you an engineer? You're great with numbers and number crunching. That's a positive thing in real estate. So use that credibility both for your own mind and in talking to your joint venture partners. Use some other credibility from other avenues of your life to justify why someone should give you their money to invest with.
Tiffany and I, in the joint venture process, we still manage a lot of properties and stuff like that. We're still the working partner in a lot, but we're not looking for money partners anymore. In fact, we're on the money partner side of it in a lot of cases now. But you know, what we do is we teach people how to communicate properly. That's really the key to finding joint venture partners. It comes down to communication. It comes down to building relationships. There's so many people out there. You know, for those of you that are listening and that are just getting started, there's so many people out there that want to invest in real estate, but don't want to do the work. They don't want the headaches. They don't want to put the time in. They don't want to be looking for properties. They don't want to manage tenants. So those are the people that, you know, especially when you're first getting going, those are the people that you end up partnering with. So how do you find those people? That's what we teach people. Where do they exist? How do you speak with them? What do you show them? What do you not show them? So that's really what our program is designed towards, is to teach people those basics so that they can have the confidence when they're having these conversations with people, and they can actually do it, you know, get out there and do one. And once you do one, it becomes so much easier after that to do your second, your third, and your fourth, and your fifth, and it can go anywhere you want it to go.
Thank you guys so much for taking some time out of your day to walk through this. I think it's hugely valuable information. And I love what you said, Tiffany. I think it's just about, you know, people are often afraid. They think they're not going to be a great joint venture partner because of X, Y, and Z. And it's really about putting yourself out there and putting yourself out there as an expert. You know, you need a couple things to be able to do that. But I think people underestimate what they're capable of when they first get into real estate. And you guys are a prime example of putting together 100 transactions in your first 3 years with none of your own money coming to the table. I mean, that's a phenomenal story. And I think that's why it's been an amazing journey for you, I'm sure.
One thing I'd just like to add, you know, for those that are watching and they think, I want to do this, but I don't think I can do it. Mm. We thought that at the beginning.
Yeah,
we saw people totally doing it. And we thought everyone else can do it, but me. And we had to build up that belief. And it just came with actually doing it and following the certain steps you need to. So Just get out there and start conversations. Get out there and start doing stuff. And it's amazing where it can take you.
Corey, Tiffany, thanks so much for joining me today. If you guys enjoyed the session today, go ahead and hit the like button below. You can also subscribe to my channel. Feel free to hit the notification bell and leave comments and questions below for Corey, Tiffany, or myself. With that, I'll say thank you guys again so much for joining me. I wish you guys, of course, the best of success in your real estate investing journey. And I look forward to catching up with you guys hopefully soon. I'm planning to make a trip back to Alberta in the summer at some point. My family's all in Alberta, so I will hopefully that we can connect at that point and spend some time and talk real estate and all of the other things that we like to talk about when we get together. So great to have you guys. Thanks again for being here and have a great rest of your week.
Awesome. Thank you.